So, particularly this session is regarding demonstration. So, I have selected some of the videos in which maintenance has been shown. So, here this is regarding a plate heat exchanger. So, here we can see an exploded view of plate heat exchanger in which these are plates. This is plate stack. In between, we were having these gaskets, these frames, these carrying bars, and guide rails. So, exploded view was shown to you, and this is how the plates are assembled in a plate heat exchanger. Along with these all plates, guiding bars, this frame, and this nut and bolts. So, this is showing how the assembly is there. Now, regarding the maintenance part of it, how do we proceed for its maintenance? Basically for maintenance, what we need to observe here is, before opening, we must observe that what is this length, means how much is the length of plate stack. So, if plate stack is of a particular length, after fitting it back, we must ensure that the length is maintained same. Otherwise, what will happen? It can be over tightened or under tightened. If under tightened, the plates will leak. If over tightened, they may get crushed. Either gasket or plates corrugation may get physically damaged. So from here, we can also see this honeycomb structure. This honeycomb structure will also give us indication that whether we have assembled it correctly or not. We can also see the tabs of gaskets. So these tabs of gaskets are there. These can be either alternating or they can be all at one side. So before opening, we must observe all these things so that we can put it back together correctly. Now here we are seeing different plates. So here we can also observe one thing, that this corrugation at this part, on one plate and on another plate, we are having some difference. So here we are having this different corrugation at this side and then on this side. So alternating AB type of configuration would be there in some of the plate heat exchanger. Basically depends on the manufacturer. Either it can be having same or ABAB or ABC, ABCD type of configuration. Now, before opening, we can mark a line. So, between this point to this point, a line can be marked so that we can ensure similarly a line here that all the plates have been assembled at correct location. Because what will happen if the correct location has not been done? So, here we just see that this line, this line will be indicating, just a second. So, this will be indicating that while opening the plates, this line will make us know that what plate is to be inserted after which plate, so that the line segment is completed after assembly. Otherwise, what happens, if we place one plate out of its place in place of another plate, then there would be some misalignment or misfitting between plates, and we must not do that. So, to avoid doing that, this type of line, at least one side should be drawn. So, this line, one line at this place, to double ensure that we have put it correctly. Now, before opening the exchanger, all these screw threads and the frame must be greased before opening, so that the plates and these bolts can be opened in a correct fashion. And these ports, there are four ports for two different fluids. As it is a heat exchanger, we would be having two fluids going in. One would be heating, another would be cooling. So those fluids must be disconnected, depressurized, and drained before opening the exchanger. Otherwise, while opening, it will leak onto the ground. So, we must recover everything. Now, in this part, it has been explained that this screw has to be cleaned. Cleaning can be done by using a wire brush, because this part can have some dust and dirt entering into the grooves. as well as this carrying bar, the supporting frame on top as well as bottom side, and greasing will ensure that during movement of this pressure plates and other plates, the scratching of plates as well as frame does not happen, and these bolts will be sliding smoothly. So that is why the greasing should be done on these sides. So all six of these bolts should be greased properly. Now for opening, suppose this is a 6 bolt plate heat exchanger. So for opening, what should we do is, we must start working from the center bolts. So we are having 2 bolts in the center. We must loose one of them first, then another. So we must work from the central bolts. So while opening, we must ensure that we are not required to open one bolt completely. So we must go incrementally. So first, this bolt has to be rotated one turn or two turn, then this bolt, then this bolt, then this bolt, like that. So firstly, these 2 bolts will be opened, removed. Then we must go for outwards. So in the case of outward, we must start with one of the bolts. Suppose we started with this, then go for diagonally. Then after this bolt, we should go with this one. Then third one would be either this or this, but it would be better if we go towards the first side. So first bolt, then second bolt, then third bolt at this side, then fourth bolt on this side. So what we should be doing is, we must be opening one or two turn at a time. Initially, we can open more turns, and as the plates loosen, then we must go for opening a smaller number of turns. So one or two turn at a time. Not all bolts have to be opened and dismantled. So all 4 are to be required to be opened progressively, simultaneously, so that there is no lateral or vertical pressure on the plate. So if we are removing, say, bottom plate, then top one would be compressed. Now here we are seeing the gasket arrangement. So in this gasket arrangement, we can see that here the this gasket line is preventing whatever fluid will come in between these two plates to go into this side, and this fluid can come in between these two plates, so fluid will be entering at this side. But in this plate, this port is blocked, this port is open. So alternatively, one of these 2 ports will be used. So this is how we are required to observe during maintenance. All the plates must be clean. For cleaning, wire brush should not be used, because the plates are very thin, very fragile, and they must be cleaned by soft brush. So nylon brush or a cloth can be used for cleaning the plates if necessary. Wire brush should not be used, because it will be physically damaging the corrugations or the plate surfaces. Then whatever cleaning solution, if any, we are using, we must ensure that it is not required to be just applied and left there. We can apply the cleaning solution, and just after some time, say 1 or 2 minutes, it has to be removed, either by wiping off or by washing off. Otherwise, what will happen? It can damage the gasket. It can come under the gasket. So the gasket, which has been placed by a suitable glue, that glue can be loosened and gasket can become come out of place. So plate heat exchanger can leak. So this precaution has to be taken care of. So general cleaning solution which are used, they are either acidic or alkaline. In the case of acidic, we use nitric acid. In the case of alkaline, we use caustic soda, a solution of caustic soda in water. So those kind of solutions are generally used. But these solution, if left for longer time, they can damage the gasket sealing material. But when the all of the plate heat exchanger is assembled, then those spaces are not there for the cleaning agent to come in between the plates and the gasket. So it generally does not do any harm to that gluing material. So at that time, that cleaning can take longer time. But after opening it up, we cannot leave the plates in the cleaning solution for a longer duration. So that is how it has to be. Now coming on to the other parts which we need to see is the corrugation. These corrugations, all the corrugation have to be cleaned properly. Now for putting the plates back together, we need to observe that line which we drew first. So this, whether that line has been maintaining the shape, then this end to end gap which was required to be measured before opening, that same gap has to be maintained. So for tightening of bolt, we must again start working from center then outside. So in this case, this is a 6 bolt heat exchanger. We can have 8 bolt heat exchanger as well. So we would be having 4 bolt at the center, 4 bolt at the edges. So in the case of 4 bolt at the center, we would be proceeding in same way, that first this bolt, then this bolt, then this bolt, then this bolt, like that. And similar condition would be there for outer bolts. But in the case of 8 bolt exchanger, we would be having opening of tightening of all bolts together. It would be not like that the first the center bolts would be tightened all together and then finally the outer edges. So all 8 bolts would be worked together. So here these two circles have been marked to show that where two other bolts can be there. In the central bolt first, then on the edges later on. So these would be how the sequence should go on. So is that part clear? So this is 1, then 2, then 3, then 4 for the central part, then here, then here, then here, and finally the top one. So initially we can tighten 2 or 3 turn at a time. And as soon as the plate heat exchanger is tightening up, the plates are coming together, nearer to each other, we must see whether any gasket is coming out, dismounting or dislodging from its place, that has to be put back in, and then tightening process has to be continued. So all these tabs, gasket tabs, are to be seen whether they are fitting back in position as they were before. So during the maintenance of any such kind of equipment, we must ensure that we are leaving the equipment the way we received it in the maintenance. And for seeing whether the exchanger has is having any leaks or not, so these 4 ports, so I have shown you that how these ports are connected by using gaskets. So 2 ports would be for one fluid, 2 ports would be for other fluid. So what we can do is, we can ensure that the fluid flow path is continuous and fluid flow path is free from blockages by connecting the intermediate ports together. Means we can supply a line at this end. The water or whatever fluid we are connecting, that will say coming out at this end, then that end can be connected to this other port at this side, and then finally we can get the fluid out at this end. Or if the heat exchanger is having a design such that the fluid which enters here exits here, then that can be connected at this side, and fluid which is entering here will come out at this side. So that is how, by only one circuit, we can test that the fluid is continuously circulating and no leakage is observed before installing it on site and testing with the product. So that part is with respect to ensuring the heat exchanger has been correctly installed back into the place. So is that clear to you?
So how do we ensure that the gaskets are placed? Because we are vertically placing the plates, so are the gaskets placed. So how do we ensure that gaskets are placed properly? Because if they are not, there will be intermixing and there will be sort of leakage and all that. How we will ensure that?
So to ensure whether the gaskets are properly placed or not, let me go back to that portion of that. Yes, here. So here we are seeing that in this plate, this part is open and this part is open. In similar plate here, we are seeing this port is blocked by this gasket. So alternatingly, if some fluid is entering at this port, it will exit at this port. Okay. So we, while ensuring, while connecting the heat exchanger back, we will be seeing that all these gaskets or all these plates are placed in such a fashion or such a way that in one plate, if this port is blocked, in the next plate, this port would be blocked.
So that is my question. Like, we place the positioning of the gasket is fine, that we have to plate alternatively. That is fine. But my point is, because it is, the plate is vertically placed. Yes. So is the gasket. So gasket is a simple sort of silicone or rubber material substance, which is too thin. So there can be dislocation once we are placing these gaskets, when we are placing the plates.
Okay, you are asking about placing the gasket on the plate.
Right.
Okay. So basically, the gaskets are not placed on the plate, they are glued on the plate.
Okay, so that means in a way, gaskets are already fixed with the plate.
Yes. Suppose if you are required to replace a plate, then it has to be replaced along with the gasket.
Okay, fine. Okay,
new plate and a new gasket. And that gasket has to be glued to the plate first.
Okay, fine. Thank you, sir.
Okay. So, in the case of plate heat exchangers, we are having specific glues like which are based on these polymers, PVA, polyvinyl alcohols. So, these glues, what they do is, they stick the gasket material to the slots or these places where gaskets are required to be placed. And that is why I told you that while cleaning these plates in open condition, we should not leave it dipped into cleaning solution, means acid or alkali. If we are leaving the gasket, this plate into that solution, then that glue can be removed. Because glue can penetrate in between the gasket glue and the plate. So, it can then dismount the gasket from its position. So, during cleaning, it has to be done immediately. We cannot leave the plate dipped in the solution. And
so that means this is done by the manufacturer only. The user has not to place the gaskets every time he installs this plate heat exchanger.
Plate heat exchanger, in this case, what is done is, during the maintenance part, the maintenance staff, whosoever is has duty of maintaining it, what he will do is, while cleaning, gasket is not required to be disturbed. If there is an observation that gasket has developed a crack or gasket has a little bit place in between the gasket and the plate, means that glue part has been removed somehow, either during cleaning or during removal of the opening of this PHE or so. Then in that case, it has to be re-affixed by using the glue, proper glue. So that would be mentioned in the service manual of the equipment, that what kind of glues can be used. So that inventory has to be maintained before opening the exchanger.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. So suppose there is a condition that out of these plates, suppose we are having 50 plates, and out of 50 plates, 10-12 plates gasket are damaged. So they have developed some cracks. They have developed some holes, pin holes, so that these blocking ports have now become somehow open. Somewhat portion are open. So, leakages are there. So, in that case, what should we do is, we should replace all the gaskets. Because when the plate heat exchanger was manufactured in the factory, all the gaskets were having the same age. If some of the gaskets have become worn out, then in near future, other gasket will also become worn out. So, there would be again and again maintenance requirement, wear and tear, failure will be there. So if we observe that the gasket, some of the gaskets have run down their service life, then all of the gaskets must be replaced simultaneously. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's fine. Got my answer.
Okay. So now this this is a video regarding how this actually it has to be done. That was an animation. So here it is being shown that greasing, and after greasing that marking, the line which I told you there, that marking should be done. So a marking has been done. Then wire brush to the screws, so that whatever particles are there, then greasing by this brush. Then this is the opening session. Then first these screws are to be opened. Firstly, the center one are to be worked and removed, and after that, the outer ones are to be worked and removed. So here you are seeing that firstly, the central ones are removed completely out of place before doing anything to the external ones. So these have been removed. After that, the remaining four, the exterior ones. So these are, this is the fashion in which they will be removed. So first, this one is unbolted. So slowly. So 2-3 turns rotation of this, then next one 2-3 rotation of that, then next bolt, and then finally the fourth bolt. So so that the removal of pressure, this bolt tightening pressure on the plates as well as gasket, is uniformly removed. Otherwise, what will happen? Suppose we loosen only the top ones, not the bottom ones, then the plates will become shrunken at the top and expanded at the bottom. There will be physical deformation either to the plate or gasket or both. Then finally removing this and then sliding it, this pressure plate, then here further step has been done. They are marking the plates. So 1, 2, 3, 4 numbering has been done so that we do not commit any mistake while reassembling. So while reassembling, this is the procedure. So it has been put back into the place. These rods are inserted back, and then they will be tightened the way they were opened. So they will be sequentially tightened. Then before tightening, the greasing is done so that there is a lesser wear and tear. This line has been observed that all the plates are well in place. During tightening, firstly tightening by hand, because now they are not having any pressure. As soon as they are developing pressure, then we can use the tools for tightening it further apart. Now the measurement of that length has been done, that what this length has to be matched on top and bottom, so that we ensure that there is no difference in the tightening pressure on the different sides. So on all four different sides, that has been measured. Then finally tightening it back into its original position. So working it in the reverse direction means tightening position. Beforehand we were having a loosening direction. So this is how it would be assembled. And after assembly, this is how the gaskets tabs are put into place if there are any gaskets which are out of place. So before finally tightening, so here you can see, and this is the tabs, gasket tabs, they are required to be perfectly aligned. So before finally tightening, after doing that all, this has to be finally maintained into the original dimensions from which it was opened. So this is how the maintenance process of gasketed type of this plate heat exchanger would be done. Okay, so we can also use some gauges or instruments to measure how much torque is required to be applied while tightening these bolts, so as to have one more further check. And here we are seeing the honeycomb structure, the alternating fashion of gasket tabs, that all work has been done correctly. And here we are also seeing this notch without notch pattern, that we have assembled it in correct order. So there are many checks. So it depends on manufacturer, and each manufacturer provides its own guidelines for the maintenance. So operator this maintenance manual has to be taken up seriously. And finally, a thin layer of oil has been applied all over to protect the surface. So this was regarding the gasketed heat exchanger. Is this part clear to you? Now I think it would be much more better clear regarding the gasket part and all other operation which were explained in the animation part.
Sir, okay. I have one question. This yes. is not with respect to this gasketed plate heat exchanger. This is with respect to, say, a farmer wants to open a dairy plant. We may not expect him to understand the technicalities with respect to maybe the maintenance of an equipment. So does it become important for the manufacturer to have like an AMC where they come for regular checks, because the farmer may not understand the importance of how they need to do certain things in terms of maintenance. So how do they go about it?
Basically, this maintenance part which I am discussing right now is specifically with respect to larger dairy plants where we do have a maintenance engineering section inbuilt inside the dairy plant with the dairy plant staff. But when we are having a condition like you said, the farmer case, in that scenario we can go for third party, either AMC from the same company, or we can have some maintenance agency involved in between. So maintenance agency, what they do is they can have some contracts just like AMC because there can be equipment from different manufacturers. One machinery can be from say IDMC, another one could be from say GIA or GOMA or something like that. So we can have one single maintenance agency which would be maintaining all the equipments, machinery part. So the persons who are involved in that maintenance should understand and should know what should be done, and they must have access to all those operator or maintenance manuals which are having the related information. The farmer need not to know this part, but maintenance itself is a very important aspect of it. And if the machinery or the equipments which are involved in the production are of such a level of sophistication, then it becomes much more important. So in that case, AMC is a must.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, going on to the next equipment, which is cream separator. So a small cream separator has been shown. So this is the tightening strip. It has been placed on the bowl. The assembly has been shown. Then this is the bowl. So bowl bottom, it is having a slot. So the slot has been already affixed into this. So it would be placed onto that strip. Then there would be a gasket or a rubber which would be placed onto the slot given. So this is the slot where, so that to make it leak proof. So basically, this is the bottom part of it. Then this is the milk distributor, so it has to be aligned and placed at the bottom. So for alignment, we can see that there was a tab in between. And finally, after this, we can start placing this disc. So disc should be go into the bowl. So here you can see this part. So these are some slots cut out in the disc which are required to fit into this distributor. That is how it will fit perfectly. So one after another, all the disc will be accommodated in the bowl. So it has to be done by rotating so that we can see that it has fit correctly. After fitting it, what we would be doing is we would be putting it with this final cover plate. So this is the top disc or a cover plate. So it is the last disc, and we are having a cream screw on the top. So which will be adjusting the cream fat percentage. So L key is there. So when we tighten the screw, then we will be getting thicker cream, means high fat cream. And if we lose this screw, we will be getting lesser fat. So it is to be placed at the top, and then we can close the bowl. So on the lower side of bowl, there is a pin. So here you can see this pin. Just that pin will go inside just like this. So this is, and then we can tighten this nut spanner at the top. It has to be firmly tightened before operating this machine. Otherwise, everything can come out. So by using this tool, it has to be tightened properly like this. So now it has become one single component. Complete bowl assembly has been done. Now it has to be placed on this spindle. So this is the spindle, so that when the motor shaft rotates it, it rotates whole bowl as a single unit. And then these spouts, different spout, milk spout will be placed first, and after milk spout, we will be placing the next spout. So here in this spout, we are seeing there are still those portions which will be fitting it. Then this is the cream spout. So it should be at least 2 mm above the cream, this screw. So this screw should be 2 mm above this spout. So because from here the cream will be coming out. And finally, this is the milk feeding portion of it. So it has been placed on top, aligning it to the outlet of the top center of the float chamber. So this is the float chamber. So float chamber will be placed here, and this float chamber outlet valve has to be aligned with the this side. And now float will be placed so that it avoids entry of any air bubbles. Air bubbles should not get inside the cream separator, otherwise it will stop cream to come out and only air will come out. So this is showing how the tap will be opening or closing. So this was regarding this smaller capacity cream separators. Now regarding the cleaning, after the separation is complete, we are required to open it for cleaning. So to clean, the process which we used for assembling it has to be done in the reverse direction. So the bowl has to be placed like this, then we are required to open this top nut has been opened, then this cover was removed, then this distributor, this top plate, and after top plate, the stack of plates that can be removed. Then it has to be washed with hot water or a cleaning solution. And finally, inside we can use this brush to clean it from the inside as well. So brush, already manufacturer provides this kind of brushes for cleaning it at the central part. Now before putting or assembling it back, these discs are required to be cleaned and washed. So for drying, the stand is there. So that that kind of stand provided should be used. So is this part also clear to you?
Yes, sir.
So this was regarding the, so we have covered cream, this plated exchanger, cream separator. Now only one more equipment which I have covered, required to cover is this spray dryer which I have planned. So in the case of spray dryer, basically the atomizer. So this is the atomizer system of spray dryer. Before going into this, let me know that whether do you know this construction and working of spray dryers or not, participants?
Sir, it would be beneficial if you would explain, sir, the working.
Okay. So basically, in the case of spray dryer, because I have not prepared this introduction to spray dryer kind of slides here. So let me explain that in the case of spray dryer, what happens, concentrated milk is sent to a hot air chamber where it is sprayed in very fine droplets. The air in that spray chamber ranges from 180 to 250 degrees Celsius in temperature. So what happens, as soon as the milk droplets come in contact with very hot air, the moisture from the surface of droplets starts evaporating instantaneously, and we get reduction in size of droplet. So when the size of droplet reduces, it shrinks down, and simultaneously moisture from the center part of droplets also migrates towards the concentrated and more drier part, which is on the periphery of the droplet, means say we are having spherical droplets. So moisture droplet, moisture part comes from the center towards the outside in the radial direction, and while doing so, it removes moisture more and more. So that spray part is produced by atomizer. As the name suggests, it breaks the droplets down to very small sizes. So this is the part which is the atomizer system. And this part here, this is a pipeline from where concentrated milk will come into it. So concentrated milk, while entering into it, will go into a part which would be rotating very fast. So it would be a spinning wheel or a spinning disc from where the fluid, while coming by centrifugal force, will be splitted into several millions of small particles. So when the droplets under the influence of gravity falls, they dry away slowly and slowly. And as by gravity we know, the rate of falling is increasing, means velocity increases. So we are having acceleration due to gravity, so speed of particle increases. But as the particle gets drier, its mass decreases. So that is providing somewhat a little reduction in speed of the particles falling, because it also depends on the mass of particle, because we are having friction due to air. So what does it takes is, it takes almost 1 to 2 seconds for a particle to fall down to a surface. So what do we have is, we have only 2 seconds for drying to complete. So spray drying is a rapid or almost instantaneous process of drying of milk. Not only milk, any food formulation which can be atomized can be dried by spray dryers. So the moisture part of this say feed is containing 60% moisture. Then within 2 seconds, it will be dropping down to almost 12 to 15% moisture. So it would be reduced to such a level that if particles are not allowed to contact each other, they remain separate. So it has to be dried further down in the second and third stage of dryer. So have you got up till this, the concept of drying?
Yes, sir. Understood, sir.
Okay. So this atomizer is known as heart of a spray dryer. It is the most important part, and this is the feed inlet pipe. This is the shaft of atomizer, and this is motor or driving part. And this part here you can see, this is the belt which will be rotating this shaft. So this shaft is connected to that wheel, this atomizer wheel. So this is the belt here, this is shaft. Now, this is the 3D modeled atomizer version. So, this green color is the belt, this is shaft, this is inlet pipe. Now, this is the spinning disc. Here we can see, this is the spinning disc part of it. And to open it, these are 2 lock nuts. So, these 2 lock nuts are to be removed first, one by one. Then we will be using a special tool for removal of this assembly. So this is a special tool which would be fit inside, then another tool will be inserted inside and then rotated simultaneously so that this whole assembly gets out. So here we are seeing a tapered shaft is there onto which this atomizer was mounted. So these slots here, these slots are the places from where the milk droplet is, where the concentrated milk will be fed into it. Along with this shaft, this shaft is a hollow shaft. It will be carrying concentrated milk into it. When this shaft will rotate, due to centrifugal force, the milk will travel towards the spinning disc periphery. This disc will be rotated at a very high speed. So it would be in the range of say about 15,000 to 20,000 RPM. So at very such a high speeds, almost instantaneously, the milk which is coming into a liquid stream drops, forms into very minute droplets. So these are the various parts shown dismantled. This is the shaft. This was the pipeline which was over the shaft, and these are various parts, different parts which are there in this assembly. Here we can see this belt which was rotating that shaft once again. So this was regarding this. Just let me. So this was regarding this part, different materials, and this is how it is under working. So here we can see the central part here. This was atomizer, and it is spraying its contents inside this chamber. This is drying chamber. So we can see a film like of this structure, because here in the testing part, instead of milk, water has been used. So that is why we are seeing this film. So this belt is rotating shaft, and this is how it can be tested. So it has been mounted on a different platform, and this is the basic wheel of this atomizer. So here we can see, after fitting, this is the atomizer, and this side hot air comes in. So we are having this vanes. So there is an outer peripheral way from where hot air at 200 degrees Celsius, 250, 180 degrees Celsius will be coming. And due to this direction of entry, the air while coming in rotates in a circular fashion. So it creates a cyclonic storm type of situation inside. So that whatever droplets come out of the atomizer, immediately they start looping around. So we can increase some time before the particle reaches the bottom. It takes a larger length to be covered due to this circular motion of this drying air. So here we are seeing the spinning atomizer. This is how it is spins. So at a very great RPM when it is spinning in this platform, we can see, and this mist kind of structure, are you able to see this mist kind of structure? This is how it atomizes in such fine droplets. So that is how this atomizer would be working. Now on the industrial scale, because this part, atomizer part, this is a heavy machinery part. This motor along with this assembly has to be lifted by a hoist. So we are having chains and hoist at the top of the dryer chamber. So after opening up all the nuts and bolts, it has to be mounted by a hoist and then lifted off. This side, this is the hot air duct which is rotating. This is encircling this atomizer part, and then it enters inside. This is the hoist which is used to lift and put back this atomizer. This is atomizer inside the dryer in working condition. Here we are seeing the mist of the spraying conditions. And this is the how the atomizer alone looks like. This is the one of atomizer. So three of them have been shown to you there. This is how it is put back into the position. And these are the slots for these bolts which would be tightened to hold it into the place. So the hoist is putting it back, placing it into its position, removing the hoist connection, and this is how it was assembled. So this was regarding the dryer part. So do we have any questions or doubts?
So the air distribution का जो बताया भाई, एक बार फिर से दिखा दें.
Air distribution वाला?
हाँ, जी.
अच्छा, ये जो आप ये वाला part आप बोल रहे हैं?
Yes, yes.
So here what we are seeing, ये जो बीच वाला, this is the atomizer dryer में इतना ही निकलता है, बाकी सारा ऊपर रहेगा. So this part here, this is air entry. Air की entry जो dryer में होगी वो ऊपर से, ये co-current dryer है, means product and the drying medium दोनों same direction से, मतलब ऊपर से नीचे की तरफ आ रहे हैं. तो parallel flow या co-current flow type का dryer हो गया. In that case, because it is falling under gravity, so we are having very less time. So dryer chamber, it is a very big structure as we know, almost 2 to 3 story building ki jitni height hoti hai drying chamber ki. So 2 story building means approximately say 20 meters. So boiler ki chimney jitna uncha ho gaya, usse thoda kam ho gaya, utna drying chamber ka height hoga. उतनी ऊंचाई से अगर कुछ चीज नीचे गिराएंगे तो वो करीब करीब एक से डेढ़ सेकंड में नीचे जमीन पर होगी। तो वी आर वेरी लेस टाइम फॉर मिल्क टू ड्राई बिफोर इट हिट्स एनी सरफेस। नहीं तो क्या होगा, अगर इनकम्प्लीट ड्राइंग हुई तो वो जिस सरफेस पर जाएगा वहां चिपक जाएगा, हटेगा नहीं। एंड फाइनली देर विल बी बर्निंग एंड स्कॉर्चिंग, स्कॉर्च पार्टिकल्स विल बी क्रिएटेड। सो टू अवॉइड दैट, एयर का एंट्री टेंजेंशियल है। सो वी आर हैविंग टेंजेंशियल एंट्री ऑफ एयर। And what does it say? What does it do? The tangential entry of air will aid in increasing the time. तो जो milk की droplets को यहाँ से निकलने में, नीचे surface पर पहुँचने में time लग रहा है, उसको बढ़ाएंगे। कैसे बढ़ाएंगे? Because of rotating air. Air is coming out of these veins, so it will rotate. Because ये circular है और ये सारे के सारे एक ही direction में मुड़े हुए हैं, so air will be rotated. इट विल फॉर्म अ साइक्लोन। तो जैसे चक्रवात आता ना साइक्लोन, उस तरह से एयर एंट्री लेगी, हॉट एयर वो 180 से 250 डिग्री सेल्सियस वाली यहाँ से एंट्री लेगी, एंड इट विल एंटर इन रोटेटिंग फैशन। सो व्हाट एवर पार्टिकल्स आर देयर, दे विल ऑल्सो रोटेट अलॉन्ग विद एयर। तो वो सीधे सीधे स्ट्रेट लाइन में नीचे नहीं गिरेंगे, तो दे विल हैव टू फॉलो अ लार्जर लेंथ बिफोर दे हीट अ सर्फेस। तो इससे क्या होगा, हमारा टाइम एक से शायद दो सेकंड हो जाए, डबल हो गया टाइम। सो हॉट एयर के अंदर जब पार्टिकल सस्पेंड होगा, इट हैज ऑल ऑफ इट्स सरफेस एरिया अवेलेबल फॉर ड्राइंग, सो दैट इज हाउ इट इज असिस्टिंग। तो ये तो हो गया आपका इंटीरियर वाला पार्ट, कि अंदर से ये हॉट एयर वाले जो सिस्टम है, यहां से आप देख रहे हैं ये वाला जो पार्ट है, ये एयर की एंट्री को ऐसे घुमा दे रहा है, रोटेट कर रहा है। एंड फ्रॉम द एक्सटर्नल पार्ट, एक्सटीरियर पार्ट से जो बाहर वाली साइड है, वहां पर वाला ये इधर दिखा देते हैं, जस्ट अभी आएगा पहले, हाँ ये वाला पार्ट, दिस वन, ये वाली जो आप डक्ट देख रहे हैं यहाँ पर खुली हुई है, ये जो एक स्क्वेयर पाइप सा है, दिस इज कमिंग फ्रॉम द एयर हीटर। तो एयर हीटर जहां पर एयर का टेम्परेचर इंक्रीज करके, एयर टेम्परेचर वुड बी इंक्रीज टू द ऑपरेटिंग टेम्परेचर की 180, 200, 250 जितना रखना है, उतने डिग्री की टेम्परेचर की एयर यहाँ पर आएगी, और एटोमाइजर का सेंटर पार्ट के बीच में इधर चक्कर मार के सर्कुलर राउंड में जाकर के फिर उसमें नीचे से एंट्री लेगी चेम्बर के अंदर। तो दिस इज द एयर सर्किट पार्ट ऑफ इट।
ओके सर, थैंक यू।
किसी और को कुछ पूछना हो तो, एनीबॉडी एल्स?
सर, व्हाट इज द कैपेसिटी ऑफ द स्प्रे ड्रायर बीइंग शोन इन द पिक्चर, द सेकंड पिक्चर, स्पेशली वो जो तीन चार इकट्ठे रखे हुए थे,
जो एटोमाइजर यहाँ पर इकट्ठे, ये वाले?
यस यस, ये वाले।
ये मैम एक्चुअली दिस इज नॉट स्प्रे ड्रायर, दिस इज ओनली एटोमाइजर, ये सिर्फ एटोमाइजर है।
अच्छा अच्छा,
ये जो हॉइस्ट से ये जो निकल रहा ना, ये चीज थी।
करेक्ट करेक्ट। मिनिमम क्या होती है सर कैपेसिटी स्प्रे ड्रायर्स की, जो लैब स्केल में ट्रेनिंग वगैरह में यूज करके डेमोन्स्ट्रेट कर सके लोगों को?
बेसिकली वो क्या, लैब स्केल में जो वो आते हैं कांच वाले आते हैं ग्लास स्प्रे ड्रायर्स, और दूसरे आ जाते हैं कि मान लो आपको प्रोटोटाइप टाइप का चाहिए,
राइट,
उसमें कैपेसिटी ज्यादा होगी। जो हमारे लैब स्केल वाले हैं, जिसमें आपको मान लो कुछ बिल्कुल ही स्मॉल क्वांटिटी में कि 100-200 ग्राम की पाउडर बनाना है दिन का, तो उसके वो तो बेंच टॉप ड्रायर्स आते हैं कि आपका जो टेबल है उसी साइज का आ जाएगा। तो जनरली क्या है, कैपेसिटी, व्हेन वी गो फॉर कैपेसिटी डेफिनेशन, कैपेसिटी फॉर इवेपोरेटर्स एंड ड्रायर्स बोथ आर जनरली बेस्ड ऑन रेट ऑफ वाटर वेपर इवेपोरेशन, बट स्पेसिफिकली इन द केस ऑफ ड्रायर इट इज ऑन द प्रोडक्ट साइड, मीन्स कि हाउ मच प्रोडक्ट इट प्रोड्यूसेस। तो अगर आप देखेंगे कि एक स्प्रे ड्रायर है, मान लीजिए हमारे पास 60 टन पर डे का स्प्रे ड्रायर है स्किम मिल्क पाउडर का, तो सेम ड्रायर इट मे बी कि 90 टन पर डे होल मिल्क पाउडर बना दे, और सेम ही ड्रायर इट मे बी पॉसिबल कि 120 टन पर डे डेरी वाइटनर भी बना दे विदाउट अल्टरिंग सिग्निफिकेंटली अल्टरिंग इट्स ऑपरेटिंग पैरामीटर। तो वो प्रोडक्ट साइड पे चला गया, क्योंकि उसमें इनिशियली ही टीएस ज्यादा है, तो प्रोडक्ट फाइनली ऑलरेडी ज्यादा बनेगा, क्योंकि मॉइस्चर कम इवेपोरेट करना पड़ेगा ना ड्रायर को।
यस सर, ठीक है सर, ठीक है, थैंक यू सो मच।
और किसी का कोई क्वेश्चन हो तो पूछ सकते हैं।
एक्सक्यूज मी सर।
जी
सर, कैन वी यूज दिस dryer means which we are using for milk powder production in fruit juice powder production?
Bilkul, we can use that for fruit juices as well, but we need to make sure ki jo hamare process parameters hain wo same nahi chal payenge. Firstly, with respect to the concentrate, because fruit juice directly dryer mein nahi jayega, fruit juice concentrate jayega. So before dryer we need an evaporation system. तो फ्रूट जूस कॉन्सेंट्रेट का टीएस मैक्सिमम पॉसिबल जितना हो सके वो टीएस हम ड्रायर को फीड देंगे, एटोमाइजर को बेसिकली, एंड देन अप टिल व्हाट लेवल ऑफ टेम्परेचर्स, बिकॉज डिफरेंट फ्रूट जूसेस हैव डिफरेंट कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट्स एंड डिफरेंट कॉन्स्टिट्यूएंट्स हैव देयर ओन कैपेसिटी की वो कितने टेम्परेचर तक विदस्टैंड कर सकते हैं. क्योंकि यहाँ ड्रायर में हमारे पास ज्यादा टाइम नहीं, 2 सेकंड का टाइम है, 2 सेकंड में इतना कुछ फर्क नहीं पड़ेगा. प्लस दूसरी बात, द पार्टिकल ऑफ द ड्राइड पार्टिकल टेम्परेचर डज नॉट राइज सिग्निफिकेंटली. सपोज इफ वी आर पुटिंग 50 डिग्री सेल्सियस इनलेट मिल्क, मिल्क की बात अगर मैं करूँ, कॉन्सेंट्रेटेड मिल्क 50 डिग्री सेल्सियस पे ड्रायर में अगर जाता है तो मिल्क पाउडर हमारे को अप्रोक्सीमेटली 65 टू 68 डिग्री सेल्सियस पर बाहर आ जाता है. इन केस जबकि एयर टेम्परेचर 180 डिग्री सेल्सियस हो तब भी, तो हम देख रहे हैं कि पाउडर का टेम्परेचर इतना 100 क्रॉस नहीं किया, बट स्टिल इट हैज इंक्रीज्ड, मतलब 10-15 डिग्री सेल्सियस इंक्रीज होगा. तो वही चीज हमें देखनी है फ्रूट जूसेस में, बिकॉज वी आर हैविंग फ्लेवर कंपोनेंट्स, वी आर हैविंग सम फंक्शनल कंपोनेंट्स, वो कितने टेम्परेचर तक जा सकते हैं, उतने टेम्परेचर को आउटलेट एक्सीड नहीं करना चाहिए. इस हिसाब के पैरामीटर्स को हमें पहले वर्कआउट करना है और तब हम ये ड्रायर्स यूज कर सकते हैं. इज माई पॉइंट क्लियर?
यस सर, यस सर, थैंक यू, थैंक यू.
तो आर वी हैविंग एनी अदर क्वेरीज? एक्चुअली पार्टिसिपेंट्स, यू मे नोट दैट की आई ऑल्सो हैव सम teaching material uploaded on YouTube. You can search with my name on YouTube. You can get that. So if it interests you, you can see further. If you are not having any more questions, then can we end this session?
Sir, I have a minor doubt regarding plate heat exchanger. Sir, if we want to increase the efficiency of the exchanger, how many plates can we add to that maximum?
Basically, heat exchanger efficiency is not dependent on number of plates, it depends on overall heat transfer coefficient. Jo performance parameter agar hum baat kare plate heat exchanger ke liye, for any machine, any equipment, the performance is based on the duty. Plate heat exchanger ya koi bhi heat exchanger hum lagate kyun hai? Heat exchange karne ke liye. To heat exchange isse zyada ho, yani ki सेम टेम्परेचर डिफरेंस अगर हॉट फ्लूइड का हम रख रहे हैं तो कोल्ड फ्लूइड का टेम्परेचर डिफरेंस ज्यादा आ पाए, ये हमारा मोटिव है. या फिर इसका उल्टा अगर इसको कूलिंग के केस में ले तो व्हाट वी विल बी डूइंग इज वी आर रिक्वायर्ड टू इंक्रीज ओवरऑल हीट ट्रांसफर कोएफिशिएंट. तो ओवरऑल हीट ट्रांसफर कोएफिशिएंट इज डिपेंडेंट ऑन द फ्लो पैरामीटर्स बेसिकली. तो प्लेट हीट एक्सचेंजर वंस सेलेक्टेड और इंस्टॉल्ड उसकी प्रॉपर्टीज तो फिक्स हैं, बिकॉज हमारे पास प्लेट का मटेरियल की भी स्टेनलेस स्टील है, हाउ मच थिकनेस इट इज हैविंग, कॉरुगेशन कितनी है, वो सब तो फिक्स है. सो व्हाट वी कैन डू इज वी कैन इंक्रीज और डिक्रीज द प्रेशर अंडर विच इट इज ऑपरेटिंग, और वी कैन इंक्रीज और डिक्रीज द फ्लो रेट. बेसिकली इतना ही बाकी रह जाता है along with the inlet temperatures. Outlet हमारे control में नहीं होते कभी भी. Along with the inlet temperatures of the fluid. तो fluid inlet temperature कितना रखना है वो fix कर दिया, तो हम pump का pressure और flow rate control करके efficiency increase या decrease कर सकते. Increase होगी अगर flow rate ज्यादा होगा. Because if flow rate is high, then heat transfer coefficient is high. And when that increases, तो जो फॉर्मूला आपने फॉर्मूला इज क्यू इज इक्वल टू यू ए डेल्टा टी, तो यू की वैल्यू इंक्रीज होने से क्यू इंक्रीज हो जाएगा. एंड इफ वी आर गोइंग फॉर इंक्रीज इन एरिया, अगर आप एरिया इंक्रीज कर रहे हैं तब आपको नंबर ऑफ प्लेट्स इंक्रीज करनी है.
ओके सर, ओके, थैंक यू.
एनीबॉडी एल्स हैज सम अदर क्वेरीज? शुड वी एंड दिस सेशन नाउ?